No, but revelry in the Lord actually is called bhakti. Devotion is reveling in the Lord. And that is what we find. Great Mahatmas, they never went rejecting the world. They start enjoying the world. Today morning also somebody asked, when Shankaracharya is Advaitin, why did he write so much about devis and various forms of gods and various different hymns and other things he wrote about all various forms of God? Because he was reveling in the Lord. He was enjoying the whole creation as such a beautiful expression of Lord in every form. I told them, just like when I see the beautiful Himalayan mountains covered with snow, you look at it, such a beauty, beautiful sunshine takes place in that beautiful, what you call the snow mountains, and you enjoy. Do you want to own it? This, you know, Himalayas, I want to take it back to Los Angeles and my backyard. You may take a picture of it. And that's what many people very busily will be doing. When they are in the Himalayas, tiki, and then they wonder once I go home, put it in the screen, Himalayas. Why don't you enjoy there? No, even if I want to own, I cannot own. I know that. But that doesn't mean that I should not enjoy it. So I enjoy the beauty of the nature without ownership, correct? Yes or no? When we are invited to go and stay in somebody's house, we enjoy everything because we don't own it. So who stops you from enjoying it? Look at it as the God's beautiful presence everywhere. Every leaf, every flower, every fruit, every sunshine, every waterfall. Everything is such beautifully created by the Lord. Why not you enjoy the Lord there in that Bhagavan is everywhere. So when you thus have no intention to own up, nor you have an intention to reject, the mind is reveling in that joy. Yogaratova, bhogaratova, sangaratova, sanga vihinaha. Yasya brahmani ramate chittam. One whose mind is reveling in that, nandati nandati nandativa. So it's just a beautiful thing. When you get attached, it is bondage. When you revel, you are free. What a beautiful thing. He is not asking you to renounce. He's not asking you to run away. Enjoy. This enjoyment does not mean pleasure. This enjoyment is devotion to God. It is not for revelry through the senses. You see through the senses, but remember the Lord. So in continuing here, Nayujyamanaya Bhaktya Bhagavatya Kilatmani Sadrushosti Shiva Pantha Yoginam Brahma Siddhaye Nayujyamanaya Bhaktya Bhagavatya Kilatmani Sadrushosti Shiva Pantha Yoginam Brahma Siddhaye. Brahma Siddhaye, to obtain that Brahman, Yoginam, for the yogis, Na Sadrushaha Shiva Pantha Asti Yujyamanaya Bhaktya Bhagavati Akilatmani. In that Bhagavati, in that Bhagavan, in that Lord, Akila Atmani, who is the self of all, Yujyamanaya Bhaktya, the attachment to that Lord through devotion, Na Shiva Panta Sadrushaha Asti. There is no other equal path. There is no other path equal to devotion to the Lord, who is the self of all, which is the most auspicious. There is no other path available for the yogi to obtain the highest. So, you know, this kind of a teaching which makes us very comfortable. Some people, in the name of this austerity or in the name of a severe meditation or tapas, they persecute their body continuously. Some people put in also, and then walking on the fire and hitting themselves, and then okay. What did the body do to for you to do all these things? Why are you torturing this body? It's a vehicle. It's a vehicle for you to do the life's journey. Why are you persecuting this? What did the body do to you? You tell me. You are only doing to the body. What did it do? It is, after all, it is taking care of your life. And why are you persecuting this? So all sort of such persecution of the body is only making you more and more become aware of the body only. I'm not eating for 2 days. And then what are you going to do? Think about it. Thinking about eating only all the time. Why do you want to fast so much? So Swamiji, I'm fasting. And what do? Fast food. Think about food only all the time. So physical body is a vehicle. Just like a vehicle that you take care so that your journey is comfortable, efficient, so also this physical body is a vehicle. Take care of it. Make it healthy. And therefore, you will continue your path without getting disturbed by it. So here he says, the devotion does not expect you to do any persecution. The devotion is such a path, there is no other equal to that. Why? Because in which you are able to consistently remember the Lord. See, the goal is abstract. We cannot comprehend what is that moksha that easily. But when it comes in the form of the Lord who is representing that, it is easy to relate yourself with. When there is a physical form which represents your goal, it is easy to identify. Let's say in some houses you go, you see the Buddha, laughing Buddha. Right? So at least when you look at it, you start laughing. You know? Laughing Buddha. And that original Buddha is so quiet. But this one is just the opposite. And fat. It's not thin. It's such a fat one. It is to show a sadhu should live in such a bliss. Not in blisters. Bliss. The happiness in this very world. Have you seen any picture of Rama or Krishna unhappy? Flute. Unhappily flying the flute. You see that? The representation of God should be blissful, joyful. Because that's what you want to reach. So here he says, there is no path equal to that path of devotion where you start reveling in the thought of the Lord. That's why the Upanishad also, Isha Vasyam Idagam Sarvam Yatkincha Jagatyam Jagat. Whatever is there in this world, look at it as nothing but Bhagavan only, the Lord only. Krishna also says, Yomam Pashyati Sarvatra Sarvamcha Mai Pashyati Tasya Aham Na Pranashyami Sachame Na Pranashyati. He who sees me in everything and everything in me, such a person never loses my attention, nor do I lose his attention. I am with him, he is with me. Our Gurudev also would say, how do you know that you are progressing spiritually? Look at the smiling faces around you. Or wherever you go, if you give joy, that is what considers your spiritual progress. And whenever you go, people are joyful, that means you are a miserable individual. You should give joy wherever you go, not whenever you go. So that means, you know, if you have found your happiness, then what else you give to people? So if you are reveling in the joyful Lord, who is everywhere in everything, how can you be unhappy? So this is what he said. There is no other path which is... Second thing is, everybody knows what is love. Is it not? Nobody needs to be told what love is. Because every living being, even if they don't utter a word, even if they are not capable of saying anything, even a plant knows what love is. You go and sing in front of the plant, it will die immediately. Because he understood, you are persecuting me. Every living being knows love. Love has no language. So that very love which we have, which is now conditioned with respect to the person, with respect to some relationship, with respect to expectations. Now when you remove all those ingredients which are conditioning love, when it becomes unconditional, such an individual revels in the joy of the Lord at all times. So one should recognize that. Here, continuing, Bhagavan says, Prasangamajarampasham Atmanakavayo viduhu Sayeva sadhu shukrutaha Mokshadvaramapavrutam Prasangamajaram pasham Atmanakavayo viduhu Sayeva sadhu shukrutaha Mokshadvaramapavrutam. Attachment is like a rope. A rope, what is the purpose of a rope? To tie. In Sanskrit, rope is known as pasha. And pasha, another meaning of pasha is attachment. Passion in English. Pasha means rope, pasha means passion also. And what is the rope with which we are now living? Passion. And when you add COM in front of it, you become released. Compassion. It's interesting. Passion towards a particular thing catches you. You get bound by that. That's why he says, prasangam attachment, extreme attachment, ajaram. Jara means that which subject to decay. Ajaram, unbreakable, undecaying. Pasham, that very passion is the rope. Didi kavayaha viduhu. Atmanaha pasham, that which is tying down your own self. Now it is interesting, this very kind of attachment. What is attachment in other words? When I say I am attached to so and so, let's say I am attached to my wife, not my wife, okay, attached to someone, something. What it means is I get identified with that. So identification means what? That person becomes my extension. Like a mother is attached to the child, it means mother considers herself extended into the child. If with respect to people, you can understand this way. Some people have attachment to the computer also. Phone. If I keep the phone here and somebody, why are you touching that? It feels like I am being touched, I am being taken away. Don't touch my computer, don't touch my phone. Meaning what? That's identification. Some people are identified with their name also. Somebody mispronounces their name. My name is mispronounced. Attachment to that name. Attachment to form. Attachment to objects. Attachment to people. You understand? Therefore, attachment means identification. I extend myself to that object, person or a thing. Nothing wrong, because when I am attached to a limited thing, that limitation of the thing binds me. The limitation of the object of attachment is limiting myself. Now, if you are attached to the same attachment, identification, when you direct to someone who is not attached to anything, what happens to you? You get detached. If I am getting attached to an object or a thing which is limited, that limitation binds me. Let me give you an example. Here's a mirror. You stand in front of it. When you stand in front of it, you see yourself. When you move, what happens? The mirror doesn't move with you. It has limitation, and only in the limited way you understand yourself. Can you see your back behind with that? No. Can you see the side of it? You cannot. You cannot see the side of it. Why? That is limited. So with the limited thing, when I get attached, I am limited by that attachment. I hope you understand that point. Let me put another example. Let us say I am attached to A, B, C, D. These are the four people I am attached to. All the time I do everything only for them. And if they are not there, who are you then? Why? Because their behavior, their presence, their absence decide my statement, my state of mind. My state of mind is decided by presence and absence of whom I am attached to. If they are not there, I am miserable. Is it not such an enviable situation? Miserable situation? You can understand with respect to people. With respect to objects, then it will be more miserable. My TV is not working. Oh! Arey bhai, TV is not working. Why are you miserable? My TV is under repair. What? One person was sitting in front of microwave, looking at it. Somebody asked, why are you looking at it so seriously? My TV is under repair. I have the habit of looking at something mindlessly. That's what I'm looking at. Now, what to do with such people? You tell me. Is it not all addictions are like this? If you are attached or addicted to a cigarette and if it's not available, then what's your condition? Miserable. The liquid spirituality. In bottles that come. If it's not available, I'm miserable. So, those objects, their qualities condition you. Now, why I'm giving you this elaborate example is, if you are directing the same attachment to the one who is detached, then what will be your quality? You become free of all attachments. That's why he says, Sayeva. That very person who is now getting attached to things, Sadhu Shukrutaha. If that very attachment which you have with objects and beings and things, if you direct towards sadhus, who are detached from everything, Moksha Dwaram Apavratam. Then the door to liberation is opened up. But make sure the sadhu whom you are getting attached to is not attached to you. Gurudev always would say, don't get hanging on to me. I'm not a donkey to carry you. You've made it very clear. Don't get attached to me. My Swamiji. Arey bhai. God, you will not become my Swamiji. What do you mean my Swamiji? My Guru. Nobody else's Guru. Guru is not owned by anybody. You cannot say my Guru only to me, not to you. Can you say my Bhagavan and not your Bhagavan? My Krishna never can become your Krishna. Now Krishna is not owned by anybody. Cannot be. Similarly, Mahatmas are those who don't get attached. The very nature of their detachment will come to you. So how do I therefore reach Bhagavan, the Lord, through those who are thinking about Him? And just because they are thinking about him only, they are not attached to anything else. And if you are thus getting attached to means identify with those sadhus who are detached, mokshadwaram apavratam, then the door to liberation will open up. As it is said in the Gita also, narakasya trividam dwaram. For the hell there are only three doorways: kama, krodha and lobha. Anger, lust and passion. Sorry, greed, if you want to say. Anger, desire, anger and greed. Kama, krodha and lobha. So the purpose, the teachings or the instructions or so to say the guidance the guru will give is to get rid of these three. Only when a person gets rid of these three, he is truly detached. And that detachment and that giving up of kama, krodha and lobha is moksha dwaram. And if you have even one of them, naraka dwaram. Desire alone, Swamiji, I have enough. That will take you to hell. That's why when we call each other also, what we say? Hello. Oh, hell. You are in hell. I am also in hell. We are both are in the same hell. Because have you ever found anybody in this world who is free of these three? Desire, anger and greed. Very, very rare to find. If one is not there, other two will be there. If two are absent, at least one will be there. Very rare to find. That's why you cannot, if at all a person comes to have a spiritual teacher in his or her life, where that spiritual teacher is free of desire, anger and greed, you consider yourself as got moksha directly. Because such a teacher alone, without a word, he will take you to that liberation. Because he himself will be reveling in that. So, Sayeva, to him alone when directed. So now, how do I identify these gurus? Some people ask this question. Swamiji, we talk about guru, but how do I know who is the guru? Some people keep their name, you know, sad guru, Sadguru. Nobody called them. Khud, apne ap, main. Paramahamsa, who told you? I am telling you myself. One fellow said Jagadguru Gadbadananda, his name. So Jagadguru, how did you get the name Jagadguru? I had only one disciple, his name is Jagat. Main uska guru hu, therefore I am Jagadguru. Or I have only one boy who is a disciple who is very sad, therefore I am sad guru. No gimmicks. Here, Kapila Maharshi says very clearly, identifying who is a guru. Now you see here. Titikshavakarunikaha Sukurdasarvadehinam Ajadashatrapashantaha Sadhavasadhu Bhushanaha Titikshavakarunikaha Sukhrdasarvadehinam Ajadashatrapashantaha Sadhavasadhu Bhushanaha. First and foremost quality of a guru is of extreme patience. Titiksha, tolerance. Meaning, tolerance here does not mean living in a mute condition, not responding to the world, living like a stone. This is not what is called here. Ability to bear but not react. Sahanam sarva dukkanam. apradikarapurvakam chinta vilaparahitam satidiksha. Sarvadukkanam sahanam, ability to bear all various imperfections and sorrows. Apradikarapurvakam, with no mind to retaliate. Chinta, worry, vilapa, lamentation, ragitam, devoid of. Sati diksha, that is called tidiksha. No, in life, small pinpricks are unavoidable. People's praise and insult, unavoidable. People differing from our opinions, unavoidable. But when we work hard, things don't happen, that is also unavoidable. We very work hard with making sure that everything is done, result won't come, unavoidable. We try to do the best for a person, that person walks away without even saying thanks, unavoidable. We work hard and we will be called failure, unavoidable. What can you do? These are the varieties of such, you know, dukkha will come to us. Not retaliating to any one of them. Sahanam. Sarvadukkhanam. Apradikarapurvakam. Without feeling a revengefulness. You did this to me? Very often the revengefulness is very subtle, you know. It's not open, it's not explicit. Only then animals react directly, you know, instinctively. But human plan. You did that. What do you call that? Scheming. Scheming. You did that, I will get back to you on somewhere. Very subtly. Rejecting, ignoring people who has ridiculed you or said something about you, or you talk about them to somebody else. You don't directly say that, you know. And that fellow, you know, thank God in Facebook there is no hate is there, like is there. No? If they put hate, you know, that fellow puts, let him put this picture, hate. Yeah, that kind of open retaliation we don't do. We do very subtly. Titiksha. Ready to bear any amount of unpredictability of situations. At the same time, karunika. This is very interesting. It is not only tolerance but positive compassion. Even to those people who did wrong. It is not mutely not retaliating to any such, you know, unhappy conditions. But converting that unhappy condition into an opportunity to express love. Karunikaha, compassionate. Why? Because sarvadehinam suhurtaha. They always think about what best I can do to people around me. Sarvadehinam, of all being, suhrutaha, suttuhrutaha. Heart is always ready to help others. And that compassion comes irrespective of who you are. Whatever you do to me, I am ready to do good to you. Now this is a famous story. Swamiji also quotes there. A person is seen, a sadhu was standing in the ocean, shore of the ocean, and he was picking up the, you know, what you call the crab, and putting it into back to the water. And whenever he picked up a crab, it stung him. It's very painful. But he passionately picked up and put it back. Somebody looked at it and said, "Why are you doing this? Are they not biting you? Why should you do this?" Because when they are thrown into the ocean by the ocean water, and they in the hot sun and the dry, sand, they are struggling to exist. So he is compassionately putting it back. While he is putting it back, but anyway. Why are you then, knowing very well they are biting you, why are you doing? He said, biting is their nature, helping is my nature. Because their nature is to bite. They always feel frightened when somebody picks up. It's not their problem. It is, that's how they are. But my nature is to help. That you cannot stop. See? If only we have that, irrespective of who that person is, if we extend without expecting anything, Suhrata Sarvadehina. Some people say, Swamiji, then everybody will take you for granted. Is it not that people say, oh, then if you always do good to everybody, then they will take you for granted. So what? You have taken for granted many things. Have you not taken the sun for granted? Have you not taken the trees and the plants and the sun and the moon and the water and the fire and the air and the space and everything we've taken for granted? Are you telling thanks to anybody? Every day, son, very thank you very much for every day you are coming to me. Do you? Surya Namaskar? Do you do Surya Namaskar every day? At least Namaskar to Surya. For giving you the light, every tree, every plant, every fruit, every vegetable, every being in this world who is doing indirectly, directly making you live, Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina. Why do we say that? I am thankful to all beings, known or unknown. I know their face or I may not know their face, but everyone is participating in making my life possible. Do you? Are you not taking for granted? Are you not taking for granted everything that is being provided to you? Have you not taken for granted your own parents? So somebody is taking you for granted. So what? So Suhrudah Sarvadehinam. And therefore, they do not have any Shatru, Ajada Shatravaha. Jata Shatravaha means those who have enemies. Ajata Shatravaha. There are no enemies for them. Shantaha, peaceful. Sadavaha, noble. Sadhu Bhushanaha, the best ornamentation of all sadhus. That is the quality of a guru. He doesn't say he has finished 92 Upanishads. By heart, all the 700 verses of Gita. Has memorized Ramayana, Bahavata, none of those things are given here. The quality of the guru is not mere shastrajna. It's not reading some shastra and becoming a scholar. Even if you have studied all the scriptures and you are not able to tolerate simple things in life, you don't qualify here. If you are intolerant, not compassionate, not having the heart for everyone, then you may be a scholar. A guru is not a mere scholar. That's why I always say saints, you know, scholars talk, saints walk. They walk what is stated in the scriptures. That's why their words are powerful. And somebody who's a scholarly quoting from 200 different scriptures, people listen and go home. Nothing will change. Whereas a word uttered by a sadhu out of his or her own experience will go deep in the heart of the person. So we will see how the sadhus help in gaining devotion. And which will be the direct path to liberation. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah, Sarve Santu Niramayah, Sarve Badrani Pashyantu, Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bad Bhavet. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti, Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha, Harihi Om.